The sight of this strange, pallid man, hardly middle-aged in aspect, yet certainly not less than a full century old, seeking at last to emerge from a cloud of fright and detestation too vague to pin down or analyze, was at once a pathetic, a dramatic, and a contemptible thing. Such is the power of wealth and of surface gestures, however, that there came indeed a slight abatement in the visible aversion displayed toward him. Especially after the rapid disappearances of his sailors abruptly ceased, he must likewise have begun to practice an extreme care and secrecy in his graveyard expeditions, for he was never again caught at such wanderings, whilst the rumors of uncanny sounds and maneuvers at his Pawtuxet farm diminished in proportion. His rate of food consumption and cattle replacement remained abnormally high, but not until modern times, when Charles Ward examined a set of his accounts and invoices in the Shepley Library, did it occur to any person, save one embittered youth, perhaps, to make dark comparisons between the large number of Guinea blacks he imported until 1766, and the disturbingly small number for whom he could produce bona fide bills of sale, either to slave dealers at the Great Bridge or to the planters of the Narragansett country. Certainly, the cunning and ingenuity of this abhorred character were uncannily profound, once the necessity for their exercise had become impressed upon him. But, of course, the effect of all this belated mending was necessarily slight. Kerwin continued to be avoided and distrusted, as indeed the one fact of his continued air of youth at a great age would have been enough to warrant, and he could see that in the end his fortunes would be likely to suffer. His elaborate studies and experiments, whatever they may have been, apparently required a heavy income for their maintenance. And since a change of environment would deprive him of the trading advantages he had gained, it would not have profited him to begin anew in a different region just then. Judgment demanded that he patch up his relations with the townsfolk of Providence, so that his presence might no longer be a signal for hushed conversation, transparent excuses of errands elsewhere, and a general atmosphere of constraint and uneasiness. His clerks, being now reduced to the shiftless and impecunious residue whom no one else would employ, were giving him much worry, and he held to his sea captains and mates only by shrewdness in gaining some kind of ascendancy over them. A mortgage, a promissory note, or a bit of information, very pertinent to their welfare. In many cases, diarists have recorded with some awe, Kerwin showed almost the power of a wizard in unearthing family secrets for questionable use. During the final 5 years of his life, it seemed as though only direct talks with the long dead could possibly have furnished some of the data which he had so glibly at his tongue's end. About this time, the crafty scholar hit upon a last desperate expedient to regain his footing in the community. Hitherto a complete hermit, he now determined to contract an advantageous marriage, securing as a bride some lady whose unquestioned position would make all ostracism of his home impossible. It may be that he also had deeper reasons for wishing an alliance. Reasons so far outside the known cosmic sphere that only papers found a century and a half after his death caused anyone to suspect them. But of this, nothing certain can ever be learned. Naturally, he was aware of the horror and indignation with which any ordinary courtship of his would be received. Hence, he looked about for some likely candidate upon whose parents he might exert a suitable pressure. Such candidates, he found, were not at all easy to discover, since he had very particular requirements in the way of beauty, accomplishments, and social security. At length, his survey narrowed down to the household of one of his best and oldest ship captains, a widower of high birth and unblemished standing, named Duty Tillinghast, whose only daughter, Eliza, seemed dowered with every conceivable advantage, save prospects as an heiress. Captain Tillinghast was completely under the domination of Kerwin, and consented, after a terrible interview in his cupulad house on Powers Lane Hill, to sanction the blasphemous alliance. Eliza Tillinghast was at that time 18 years of age, and had been reared as gently as the reduced circumstances of her father permitted. She had attended Stephen Jackson's school opposite the courthouse parade, and had been diligently instructed by her mother before the latter's death of smallpox in 1757 in all the arts and refinements of domestic life. A sampler of hers, worked in 1753 at the age of 9, may still be found in the rooms of the Rhode Island Historical Society. After her mother's death, she had kept the house, aided only by one old black woman. Her arguments with her father concerning the proposed Kerwin marriage must have been painful indeed, but of those we have no record. Certain it is that her engagement to young Ezra Whedon, second mate of the Crawford Packet Enterprise, was dutifully broken off, and that her union with Joseph Kerwin took place on the 7th of March, 1763, in the Baptist Church, in the presence of one of the most distinguished assemblages which the town could boast, the ceremony being performed by the younger Samuel Windsor. The Gazette mentioned the event very briefly, and in most surviving copies, the item in question seems to be cut or torn out. Ward found a single intact copy, after much search in the archives of a private collector of note, observing with amusement the meaningless urbanity of the language. Monday evening last, Mr. Joseph Kerwin of this town, merchant, was married to Miss Eliza Tillinghast, daughter of Captain Duty Tillinghast, a young lady who has real merit added to a beautiful person to grace the connubial state and perpetuate its felicity. The collection of Durfee Arnold letters, discovered by Charles Ward shortly before his first reputed madness, in the private collection of Melville F. Peters, Esquire of George Saint, and covering this and a somewhat antecedent period, throws vivid light on the outrage done to public sentiment by this ill-assorted match. The social influence of the Tillinghasts, however, was not to be denied, and once more Joseph Kerwin found his house frequented by persons whom he could never otherwise have induced to cross his threshold. His acceptance was by no means complete, and his bride was socially the sufferer through her forced venture, but at all events, the wall of utter ostracism was somewhat worn down. In his treatment of his wife, the strange bridegroom astonished both her and the community by displaying an extreme graciousness and consideration. The new house in Olney Court was now wholly free from disturbing manifestations, and although Kerwin was much absent at the Pawtuxet farm, which his wife never visited, he seemed more like a normal citizen than at any other time in his long years of residence. Only one person remained in open enmity with him, this being the youthful ship's officer whose engagement to Eliza Tillinghast had been so abruptly broken. Ezra Whedon had frankly vowed vengeance, and though of a quiet and ordinarily mild disposition, was now gaining a hate-bred, dogged purpose, which boded no good to the usurping husband. On the 7th of May, 1765, Kerwin's only child, Anne, was born, and was christened by the Reverend John Graves of King's Church, of which both husband and wife had become communicants shortly after their marriage, in order to compromise between their respective congregational and Baptist affiliations. The record of this birth, as well as that of the marriage 2 years before, was stricken from most copies of the church and town annals, where it ought to appear, and Charles Ward located both with the greatest difficulty after his discovery of the widow's change of name had apprised him of his own relationship, and engendered the feverish interest which culminated in his madness. The birth entry, indeed, was found very curiously through correspondence with the heirs of the loyalist Dr. Graves, who had taken with him a duplicate set of records when he left his pastorate at the outbreak of the revolution. Ward had tried this source because he knew that his great-great-grandmother, Anne Tillinghast Potter, had been an Episcopalian. Shortly after the birth of his daughter, an event he seemed to welcome with a fervor greatly out of keeping with his usual coldness, Kirwan resolved to sit for a portrait. This he had painted by a very gifted Scotsman named Cosmo Alexander, then a resident of Newport, and since famous as the early teacher of Gilbert Stuart. The likeness was said to have been executed on a wall panel of the library of the house in Olney Court, but neither of the two old diaries mentioning it gave any hint of its ultimate disposition. At this period, the erratic scholar showed signs of unusual abstraction, and spent as much time as he possibly could at his farm on the Pawtuxet Road. He seemed, it was stated, in a condition of suppressed excitement, or suspense, as if expecting some phenomenal thing, or on the brink of some strange discovery. Chemistry or alchemy would appear to have played a great part, for he took from his house to the farm the greater number of his volumes on that subject. His affection of civic interest did not diminish, and he lost no opportunities for helping such leaders as Stephen Hopkins, Joseph Brown, and Benjamin West in their efforts to raise the cultural tone of the town, which was then much below the level of Newport in its patronage of the liberal arts. He had helped Daniel Jenkins found his bookshop in 1763, and was thereafter his best customer, extending aid likewise to the struggling Gazette that appeared each Wednesday at the sign of Head. In politics, he ardently supported Governor Hopkins against the Ward party, whose prime strength was in Newport, and his really eloquent speech at Hatcher's Hall in 1765 against the setting off of North Providence as a separate town with a pro-Ward vote in the General Assembly did more than any other one thing to wear down the prejudice against him. But Ezra Whedon, who watched him closely, sneered cynically at all this outward activity, and freely swore it was no more than a mask for some nameless traffic with the blackest gulfs of Tartarus. The revengeful youth began a systematic study of the man and his doings whenever he was in port, spending hours at night by the wharves with a dory in readiness when he saw lights in the Kirwan warehouses, and following the small boat which would sometimes steal quietly off and down the bay. He also kept as close a watch as possible on the Pawtuxet farm, and was once severely bitten by the dogs the old Indian couple loosed upon him. In 1766 came the final change in Joseph Kirwan. It was very sudden and gained wide notice among the curious townsfolk, for the air of suspense and expectancy dropped like an old cloak, giving instant place to an ill-concealed exaltation of perfect triumph. Kirwan seemed to have difficulty in restraining himself from public harangues on what he had found or learned or made, but apparently the need of secrecy was greater than the longing to share his rejoicing, for no explanation was ever offered by him. It was after this transition, which appears to have come early in July, that the sinister scholar began to astonish people by his possession of information which only their long-dead ancestors would seem to be able to impart. But Kirwan's feverish secret activities by no means ceased with this change. On the contrary, They tended rather to increase, so that more and more of his shipping business was handled by the captains whom he now bound to him, by ties of fear as potent as those of bankruptcy had been. He altogether abandoned the slave trade, alleging that its profits were constantly decreasing. Every possible moment was spent at the Pawtuxet farm, though there were rumors now and then of his presence in places which, though not actually near graveyards, were yet so situated in relation to graveyards that thoughtful people wondered just how thorough the old merchant's change of habits really was. Ezra Whedon, though his periods of espionage were necessarily brief and intermittent on account of his sea voyaging, had a vindictive persistence which the bulk of the practical townsfolk and farmers lacked, and subjected Kerwin's affairs to a scrutiny such as they had never had before. Many of the odd maneuvers of the strange merchant's vessels had been taken for granted on account of the unrest of the times, when every colonist seemed determined to resist the provisions of the Sugar Act, which hampered a prominent traffic. Smuggling and evasion were the rule in Narragansett Bay, and nocturnal landings of illicit cargoes were a continuous commonplace. But Whedon, night after night, following the lighters or small sloops which he saw steal off from the Kerwin warehouses at the Town Street docks, soon felt assured that it was not merely His Majesty's armed ships which the sinister skulker was anxious to avoid. Prior to the change in 1766, these boats had for the most part contained chained Negroes who were carried down and across the bay and landed at an obscure point on the shore, just north of Pawtuxet. Being afterward driven up the bluff and across country to the Kerwin farm, where they were locked in that enormous stone outbuilding which had only high narrow slits for windows. After that change, however, the whole program was altered. Importation of slaves ceased at once, and for a time Kerwin abandoned his midnight sailings. Then, about the spring of 1767, a new policy appeared. Once more the lighters grew wont to put out from the black, silent docks, and this time they would go down the bay some distance, perhaps as far as Namkett Point, where they would meet and receive cargo from strange ships of considerable size and widely varied appearance. Kerwin's sailors would then deposit this cargo at the usual point on the shore and transport it overland to the farm, locking it in the same cryptical stone building which had formerly received the Negroes. The cargo consisted almost wholly of boxes and cases, of which a large proportion were oblong and heavy, and disturbingly suggestive of coffins.